Hello, welcome to Legislative Report. I'm State Representative Kate Harper of the 61st District in Montgomery County. It's hard to believe, but the technology that once could only be seen as a Hollywood special effect is now a reality. Autonomous vehicles, self-driving cars. The Pennsylvania Department of Transportation has studied this technology at great length and is pushing to be at the forefront of using it. They assigned a special task force that has recommended guidelines for introducing these vehicles to our roads, and they've applied to the federal government asking to be designated as an autonomous vehicle proving ground pilot. So joining me today to discuss this is PennDOT's Deputy Secretary Kurt Myers. Mr. Myers, welcome to the program.
Kate, thanks for inviting me.
Well, you know, when we do these programs, I always like my guests to explain to the audience a little bit about your background. Where'd you grow up? Are you a Pennsylvanian? Where'd you go to school? That sort of thing. So tell us about yourself.
Absolutely. I was born and raised in Pennsylvania, just outside of Harrisburg. And I went to college at Kenyon College, which is in Ohio, for 4 years, and came back to the area and have been here ever since. Been the deputy secretary for PennDOT since 2007.
Wow, okay. So do you have an engineering degree?
No, I do not. Actually, my degree was a BEA in liberal arts.
Wow, notwithstanding that, I know you know an awful lot about autonomous vehicles.
Well, every day goes by, we learn a little bit more, and in fact, it's a very large subject matter to understand and to grasp, and the technology is changing very, very rapidly.
All right, well, let me start off with my bias here. I'm such a control freak that I don't even use speed control. And I've read where autonomous Tesla crashed into a truck and somebody got killed. And so when PennDOT brought the vehicle over here to the Capitol, I was afraid to ride in it. But you served as chair of a task force. So what did you learn?
Well, we learned a great deal. We're very fortunate that Secretary Richards is a very forward-thinking secretary, and she's looking to the future on how new technologies may impact the future, not only for the department, but also for the citizens of the Commonwealth. And that she decided back in the spring of last year, in 2016, to put together a task force, of which I co-chaired with another representative from PennDOT. And the idea was is to bring together experts in the field of automated autonomous vehicles and have them meet and discuss and start work on developing policies for oversight of the vehicles from a testing standpoint. And so we had representatives from Carnegie Mellon University as well as University of Pennsylvania. We had gentlemen that represented General Motors there. In addition, we had a representative from Uber. Not to mention a number of other state agencies, such like as the Department of Insurance, as well as the Pennsylvania State Police, because obviously enforcement is a big part of the ultimate deployment of autonomous vehicles.
Okay, so some people have said that these autonomous vehicles are the wave of the future. They're coming whether we want them or not, Kate. You know, get used to it. And that they might actually be very beneficial for seniors who are aging at home and maybe shouldn't be driving, or disabled people who find it difficult to get to a special bus stop with a special kind of bus that can pick them up. So tell me about that. How could they be used in those ways?
Well, Kate, the opportunities here are really something that I'm extremely excited about. You know, in my position, we have a mandatory reporting law in Pennsylvania when somebody is no longer able to drive, where either law enforcement or doctors are required to report individuals who they believe may be a danger to themselves or to others on the roadway. And while I can take someone's license away, that's a very difficult thing to do.
Oh, believe me, I know it. In my district office, we have many a senior come, right, you know, very distressed, mm-hmm, that PennDOT sent them a letter taking their license.
Right. And the only choice that individual has at that point in time is to rely on a friend, a family member, or some type of scheduled transit. Well, that's today, but in the future, automated vehicles hold the opportunity for individuals to be able to have a vehicle come arrive at their home, or if they're in a skilled nursing facility, arrive at that site, pick them up, take them to where they want to go, spend as much time as they want on their schedule, which is a big difference than what we have today, where we're always on somebody else's schedule if we're dependent upon them, so that they can then do their shopping, whatever it may be that they need to do, doctor's appointments, and then be able to have that vehicle come and pick them up and then take them back to their residence in a way and in a manner that is under their control, not someone else's. And I think that's the biggest thing that we see and really speaks to the quality of life for the citizens of the Commonwealth and for that matter, the world, as these vehicles get deployed. It really opens the door up for opportunities that just today don't exist, but this technology will allow for.
Well, I have to say, many seniors won't use Uber or Lyft or one of those types of driving services. But I understand that those types of companies are in favor of these autonomous vehicles. Why is that?
That's correct. And I think that when we look at technology, and this is very transformative technology. This is really equivalent to when the automobile itself was introduced. And people always ask me, well, how will this impact or how will this change jobs? And clearly there will be job change. There'll be an evolution.
Fewer Uber drivers or fewer Lyft drivers or whatever.
Potentially there would be. But we also know, just as the wagon wheel repair person who used to fix the wagon wheels of companies, when vehicles were introduced, they became the auto mechanic. And even today now, we don't call them auto mechanics anymore. We call them automotive technicians. Why? Because they're working on computers. And so the future holds that there will be changes to job responsibilities, but there will still be a need. And in fact, even in the automotive end of the business, the automotive technicians will need to know not only how to fix the computers of the vehicles as they do today, but they're also going to have a working knowledge of lasers and radar and things of that nature, which is the technology that helps an autonomous vehicle operate.
All right. Well, hold the thought about the technology, because I have a car that can do all sorts of wonderful things, and it keeps telling me I need air in my tires, and I know I don't. But that's another story.
Right.
So we have to worry about whether the technology's up to the task. There was another part of the marketplace that I think is interested in these driverless vehicles, and that scares me a little, and that would be the trucking industry, mm-hmm. because they're having trouble finding CDL drivers. Right. Is it safe to have to be on the road with a truck that doesn't even have a driver?
Well, certainly there's a lot of work still to be done, and that's why the task force, when the task force did its work over the summer and made its report to Secretary Richards in November of this year, we focus just on the testing of these vehicles, not on the actual deployment.
Okay.
We want to be sure that these vehicles are tested in a safe way. You know, in PennDOT, obviously our focus is on safety. And when we look at the scales between assisting in this technology being advanced and the safety of the general public, clearly our scales are always going to lean to public safety. But with that said, we think there are great opportunities out there. The trucking part of the business is called, in some areas, platooning, where one truck follows another truck. And then there are cases where you can also have a truck that operates autonomously. Now, in all those cases right now, and where the technology is at, there is always a driver behind the steering wheel. They may not be touching the steering wheel, but there's always a driver behind the steering wheel.
Right now. But in the future, I could see, if they get approved, the trucks driving themselves?
It's potential. And the technology is certainly being developed that would allow for that. I think one of the things that your viewers need to know is that the deployment of autonomous vehicles will be over a long period of time. I always note to people today that even today, we still have in Pennsylvania 5% of the registered vehicles on the roads that are used every day that are 1995 and older. So you can see it's 21 years and we still have 5% of the vehicle population. So even if autonomous vehicles, whether they be trucks or whether they be passenger cars, even if they were deployed in the beginning in the next 5 years, it would be many, many years until they were fully integrated into the general population.
But they would be driving in the interim and maybe forever. These autonomous vehicles or driverless vehicles will be driving with people like me or people like my viewers who are out there with them. And do you think that's safe?
Well, I think there are, again, the focus is for us right now is on testing, because we want to ensure that when these vehicles are deployed, whether it's through some commercial application like Uber or just a general passenger car, that they are done so in a safe manner. And I want to be clear, one of the things that National Highway Traffic Safety Administration did in the fall of this year, in September, was to release some guidelines on the testing of autonomous vehicles. And one of their focuses was certainly on how one describes what an autonomous vehicle is. And you had mentioned about the Tesla vehicle.
Well, everybody heard that newspaper story about how the Tesla, which was supposed to be an autonomous vehicle and had a guy in it,
And it really
crashed into a truck because it didn't recognize a truck or something.
Right. And it is not a fully autonomous vehicle. And in fact, the features that are on the Tesla are similar to many other vehicles out there, which are driver assist.
When you back up and it tells you you're too close, or some cars I know can parallel park themselves, which would be a very useful thing to have.
Right. Yeah, so those are driver assist features. That's very,
they're not
very
autonomous.
Not autonomous.
Okay.
Now, with that said, certainly as the technology evolves, it will inevitably, these types of features will inevitably lead to many of the features that will be on an autonomous vehicle. But it's not there yet. And it's very, very unfortunate. It's tragic that an individual lost their life in that vehicle. But I would point out to your viewers that today, in the last year, 35,000 individuals lost their lives on our nation's highways. And so autonomous vehicles really pose the opportunity to be able to significantly reduce the number of individuals who lose their lives every year.
Yeah, the other way of looking at it is that these driverless vehicles are better drivers than some drivers who are out there.
You know, interestingly enough, I've had the opportunity to be in an autonomous vehicle. In fact, we had one here in Harrisburg a few months ago. And one of the things that you first notice about an autonomous vehicle, when I sat in it and we started off, at first there's a great deal of excitement because, this vehicle is driving itself. And what you find out, though, after about the first minute or two is that, number one, it's very mundane. And number two is that the vehicle obeys all the traffic rules. So if the speed limit's 25, it actually goes 25, and it turns its turn signal on when it's changing lanes, and it does all the things that it's supposed to based upon what the requirements of the vehicle code, which is another interesting challenge, because it's something then that has to be addressed from the standpoint of how you develop this technology, because, as I noted, the deployment will be over a number of years, and so there will be this interaction between autonomous vehicles and vehicles that are still driven by humans. And so that technology also has to adjust for those types of issues as well.
Well, I have to say, not every driver turns on his turn signal when he's supposed to or goes the speed limit.
Right, right. That's absolutely true. And there are varying definitions of what yield means as well.
So, yes.
So certainly from the standpoint of the autonomous vehicles, they're programmed to follow the rules as they're set.
All right. Well, hold that thought, because we're going to take a quick break. And Legislative Report will return in just a moment. Stay with us.
Did you know that Act 16 of 1999 honors one of the greatest leaders in the Pennsylvania House of Representatives? The Matthew J. Ryan Legislative Office Building, once known as the Capitol Annex, is located next to the main Capitol building and honors the late Speaker of the House, Matthew J. Ryan. Those who visit this building will observe the magnificent architectural designs, providing eloquence and grandeur to the building. Known as one of the greatest members in the history of the Pennsylvania State House, Matthew Ryan started his career in the legislature in 1963 and was elected speaker in 1981. His charisma and knowledge will forever be reflected in the building now named after this great legislative leader. Now you know.
Did you know that Violet Oakley was the first female artist to receive a large commission for artwork done in a United States Capitol building? In 1902, Joseph Houston, designer and architect for the 3rd Harrisburg Capitol building, commissioned Violet Oakley to paint murals for the governor's reception room. He believed that Oakley's contribution would add interest to the building and act as an encouragement of women of the state. Prior to beginning her work for the Capitol, Oakley set out to England to conduct research for her murals. Upon return, she decided to center her artwork on William Penn and the founding of Pennsylvania. Oakley made sure that Penn's ideals of justice and peace could be seen throughout her work. In 1906, she completed 13 murals titled The Founding of the State of Liberty Spiritual and was placed in sequential order around the governor's reception room. These murals were some of the first to be installed in the Capitol. When Edwin Austin Abbey, another artist for the Capitol, died in 1911, Oakley was offered another opportunity to create murals for the unfinished Senate and Supreme Court chambers. Her work on the Senate murals, including International Understanding, was completed by 1919. Oakley then completed the Supreme Court murals, including the Divine Law, by 1927. Oakley is said to be the principal artist for the Capitol, with a total of 43 murals on display. She remains one of the greatest muralists in the United States. Now you know.
Welcome back to the program. Today I'm discussing the future of self-driving vehicles with my guest, Deputy Secretary of PennDOT, Kurt Myers. We've been talking about cars, trucks, how this technology of the future is already here today, or at least some of it. And I know that Pennsylvania is trying to be in the forefront of this, and PennDOT had actually joined in an application to the federal government to be an experimental place to try these things. Can you tell us about that?
Right. About a month and a half ago, the U.S. Department of Transportation set out an invitation across the country to ask for jurisdictions and other entities that may be interested in being designated as a proving ground. Now, from the standpoint of the proving ground designation, it simply is something that then is set to encourage the development of the testing of autonomous vehicles. And we know that we had a lot of competition. We took a little bit of a unique approach. PennDOT took a lead position, and we had three other groups that entered with us, but also entered separately. And so we had the city of Pittsburgh, we had Penn State University, and then we also had Pocono Raceway. And the selections just came out on Friday. And of the 10 selections that crossed the entire country, Pennsylvania received two of them.
Wow.
Pittsburgh and Penn State. So we're very pleased with that. We think it generates some significant opportunities moving forward in the development of this technology. And we're thankful that that those two locations were chosen, and we'll continue to work with them as we move forward.
All right, so what does that mean? Does that mean there'll be driverless cars driving around Pittsburgh?
Well, there is today.
I heard that.
Yeah, and you know, it's interesting because Carnegie Mellon University is a institution that has been a leader in robotics for the last 30 years. And clearly, Pennsylvania is blessed with a lot of very, very fine institutions. And as I mentioned, Penn State being chosen as a proving ground. As I also mentioned earlier, University of Pennsylvania has done a lot of work in this area and is on our task force. And so in the development of these autonomous vehicles, Carnegie Mellon has had a vehicle that they've been driving around the streets of Pittsburgh now for about the last 5 years.
Wow.
And as you may be aware, the spring of this year, Uber began to drive its autonomous vehicles around Pittsburgh as well. And their most recent announcement back in September is when they began to take non-fare paying passengers in these vehicles. And part of the reason they wanted to do that is that they wanted to encourage people to experience the technology that they otherwise wouldn't perhaps
have an opportunity to do. So it's not like me, too afraid to get into the driverless vehicle.
Oh, you know, as I said earlier, it's a little different, but once you do it, allowing somebody else to do the driving is a interesting experience.
Well, I am absolutely sure that many of my commuting residents back home would love to be able to work. You know, we wouldn't have the problem with people sending texts and getting texts and not watching what they're doing if they could actually do the texting mm-hmm. or the emailing right from their phones while yeah. somebody else or something else drove the car.
Right. And it's interesting because of the opportunities. We were talking about trucks earlier, and one of the ideas that's been presented from a conceptual standpoint, looking into the future, is for a professional truck driver to be driving a truck, and for you as a passenger driving a passenger vehicle to be able to get on a highway and electronically connect to that truck. And that truck would then drive down the road, and you'd be able to take your hands off the steering wheel, look at your iPad, do your crossword puzzles, whatever it may be, check on your emails, read the newspaper if you'd like, and then that professional driver would take you down the road. So if your trip's 300 miles, you would just simply stay behind that truck the entire time, and then when you got to your exit, you simply would be able to take control of the vehicle and get off the road. But
okay.
all that driving done by a truck driver.
So I can see that. If I were to drive out here to Harrisburg, it's about 108 miles or mm-hmm. something like that, you know, to do that from my house. I could see it on the turnpike. The mm-hmm. road's flat, straight, you know, pretty well patrolled, and also doesn't have too many curves in it at mm-hmm. all. I could see that. But Pittsburgh, Penn State? What does the car do if somebody darts out in front of it, as college students mm-hmm. are wont to do, or in cities where people not watching what they're doing step off the curb?
Right.
How does that work?
Well, and that's the reason why in Pennsylvania today you need to have a licensed driver behind the steering wheel so that they're able to be watching and also be able to take the control of the steering wheel immediately if something does go amiss, either with the technology itself or if something unexpected happens that the technology doesn't react to. Again, as I noted earlier, there's a lot of challenges, Kate. There's a long way to go from a technology standpoint.
But as a legislator, what I need to know is, certainly I'm in favor of experimenting and trying it and seeing if it'll mm-hmm. work as long as it can be done safely. But, you know, when do we go further? How do we
Right.
license driverless vehicles, if you will, or register them?
Right.
Or do we do something special to make sure that they get tested every 6 months to make sure that the idiot light is actually working? Mm-hmm.
Well, those are many of the questions that the task force looked at. And understanding today under the current vehicle code, and of course, when the vehicle code was put together decades ago, no one ever anticipated that there would be autonomous vehicles. That was just not even in people's
right,
wildest imagination.
We are always tuning it up.
Sure.
You know, 4 feet from a bicycle, that's a fairly recent
right. mm-hmm.
thing, or if the intersection doesn't
right.
trip when you sit on it long enough, you can go, that mm-hmm. kind of stuff. We are tuning it up every day.
Absolutely, and that's why one of the tasks of the task force was to identify things that could be changed in the vehicle code that will allow us more flexibility in being able to have oversight of these companies that are doing testing. And so we recognize that, and it's important working with the legislature to ensure that we're taking the steps necessary to ensure that public safety. Because, as I said earlier, that is our foundation.
And it's not just the safety of the passenger in the vehicle, or if they're a driver
right.
or whatever they are. It's the safety of everybody else on the roads.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So then I'm interested in something else. The people who are coming up with the technology might be, I don't know, academics, engineers, that mm-hmm. sort of thing, or computer whizzes. But the people who want to use it are going to be either regular citizens or companies that own fleets of vehicles, or how does that all work together?
Right.
Do the people who are coming up with the technology perceive the world, you know, the same way that the other folks do?
That's an excellent question. And it's one, frankly, that was recognized by NHTSA in their guidance.
And who's NHTSA?
The National Traffic Highway Safety Administration.
Okay.
They recognize the fact that there's an ethical component to the development of autonomous vehicles.
Right.
And it's an area that has to be dealt with sooner rather than later. We need to deal with these types of questions now in the testing environment as opposed to the day when they get deployed and then deal with it. So the time is now to really ask those tough questions and to work through them. You're right that there are individuals that are programming these decisions within these vehicles, and we need to be sure that it's consistent with the way that the average person would also perceive those same situations.
And would do what they would do. Now,
right.
If you had a choice between running off the road or hitting a deer, some people would run off the road.
Right.
What will a car do?
Right.
I just don't know, you know?
It's a very good question, and these are the types of questions that the developers of these vehicles are asking themselves, and quite frankly, it's the type of questions that we're asking as well.
It does seem that by putting these vehicles as testing, you know, testing them in city environments or university environments would be a good way to see some of these unexpected occurrences and how the vehicle handles it.
It is.
There are a lot of pedestrians in both of those situations.
Correct. And it's in a very controlled environment. And I can assure you, because I've had a number of conversations with the manufacturers, like General Motors, as I noted, were on our task force, Uber. They're very, very, very concerned about safety and ensuring that any type of testing and or deployment is done in a safe manner. So their interests are also there to ensure that they get a product that is going to meet the expectations of our customers and what we talked about earlier about mobility and freedom while doing it in a safe way.
Right. I definitely think it's got some advantages for people who are aging in place, which is a lot of Pennsylvanians, okay? Because if you're aging in place in the suburbs, like my district, mass transit is just not effective. Doesn't go where you need it to go, doesn't go when you need it to go, and you can't get to it from here, So it's an issue. So if you could order up a car, like Uber or Lyft or something, and have it show up, and take you someplace, that might be a big advantage for people. Might allow them to stay in their houses right. longer, or might allow a disabled person to live in in the community or something like that where they can't do it now. So there can be some big advantages. But in this brave new world we're about to head into, what can I tell people who are worried about it, who don't want to be on the road with a driverless truck or something? What do I tell people?
Well, I think the reality is that this technology is coming. And it's really not a question of if, it's really just a question of when. And those estimates have ranged everything from 5 years, 10 years, 15 years before you'll really start to see the
Wow.
technology on the roads in any kind of large measure. So it's best that Pennsylvania has taken a leadership role, not only nationally, but internationally, in our efforts in the development of this testing protocol. And so I think your viewers should be confident to know that we are taking that leadership role to maintain those very things related to those concerns and that individuals may have related to safety.
Well, it's pretty exciting.
It really is.
All right. Well, thank you very much. That's all the time we have for today's program. I'm State Representative Kate Harper. My guest today is Deputy PennDOT Secretary Myers, who is here to talk about autonomous vehicles, driverless cars and trucks. It was a very interesting interview, and I appreciate your time very much. But if you need help with any state government matter, please feel free to contact me at my local office. The address and number will be shown in just a moment. Thanks for watching. Please join me next time for Legislative Report.